What's going on, my friend? This is Dustin Stelzer with Electrician U, and today we're going to talk about a whole bunch of different commercial materials that you should know if you're getting into commercial electrical work. So there's going to be a whole ton of things that are not on this list. I'll probably do several more of these videos, but I think I just pick things that doing commercial, I knew as an apprentice coming in, I'm like, why do I need to know that? And what is that called? And why is this different than this? And I think it'll just help give a foundation, somewhere to start for apprentices to start understanding what these materials do. Number one is the 1900 box. So this is essentially a multi-use box. It's called a 1900 box because it's called a 1900 box. It's not actually 1900 of anything. That's just what it's called. There's a 2100 box that's a little bit larger than this. But what you do is you put a device in it. So you could have a receptacle or you could have a switch inside of here, and you bring all of your wires into these knockouts around the sides. You can also just use it as a junction box, a place to make joints and, you know, hide the box somewhere. But you need to know a 1900 box because you're going to use the crap out of these things. Next up is the industrial cover. So this is an industrial cover. It actually fits on an 1900 box. So both of these together, you know, you'd probably mount this on a wall somewhere and then you wire everything inside of the box, put that on there, looks all nice and pretty. That is the industrial cover. Next up is the mud ring. So there's a bunch of different size mud rings. They come in different depths. They come in different numbers of devices, but essentially this is very similar to an industrial cover in that you would put this on the front and you could put a receptacle in this, and it allows you to put sheetrock over it. So if you're actually going to hide some of this behind sheetrock, you know, you're gonna want to use a mud ring, and this whole box is going to be recessed in the wall a little bit more. Usually there's going to be a bracket on that too. That's coming up. Next up is the bracket box. So this is still a 1900 box or a four square box, whatever you call it. There's probably a lot of people that call it a 4x4x1. There's probably 30 names for this box, but what I call this is a 1900 bracket box. And what it does is allows you to actually stand it up on something and then screw it in place. Normally you're gonna be doing this on a wall, you know, like, I don't have a wall here. So if this is a stud, the box screws to it. But same thing, 1900 box, just has brackets on it, so we call it a bracket box. The next box that you wanna know is the gangable box. Some people call this a cut-in box or a pop-in box, but typically you're gonna be cutting sheetrock and sticking this inside of a hole into a wall and then running wires into it and then having a device inside of here. Whatever you call it, they call it gangable because there's screws here and you can actually remove these plates, and you can stack multiple of them together to make like a 3 or a 4 or a 5 or a 7 or a 10 gang box if you want to. Kind of a neat idea, actually, to be able to remove the sides on these. But in practice, I personally think they could be way better accomplished with something else. These are some of the biggest pains in the butt to try to get in the wall. You got to cut them out just right, make sure that the ears are adjusted a perfect way, and you know, depending on what kind of connector you're using, and may have to cut a little bit bigger hole, and they're just a pain in the butt to work with. But you're gonna work with them a lot, so just know the cut-in gangable box. Next up are MC connectors. So there are single MC connectors that a single piece of MC cable goes into. The wires stick out here, the sheathing kind of snaps and locks in place. These are just two different styles of snap-in connectors. So you would literally just knock one of these holes out and snap this thing in place. It locks in and then you run your wire into it. But we call this a single barrel MC connector, or a single barrel connector. These are double barrel connectors because you can put two wires in them. There's a whole bunch of different styles. This is one that actually has a lock ring on it, and you know, it's threaded. So you could stick it into a hole and, you know, put the lock ring on, tighten it in place, whereas these ones actually snap in place. Just a matter of preference, really. But you're going to run MC a lot in commercial, so you need to be familiar with the different kinds of MC connectors. All right, so next on our list is MC cable. We just talked about the MC connectors. So this is MC cable. Essentially, it's going to be the same thing as Romex on the inside. You know, we talked about this in the residential one of these videos, but you know, inside it's just got regular conductors. It's just the sheathing that's different. This stuff rips and tears. It's okay for houses. Actually, you can use that for commercial too, depending on your jurisdiction, depending on the situation. But most of the time you're going to be using MC because it's a lot more rigid, it's harder to break. So just understand when people say MC, this is what they're talking about, something that looks like this. There's all different kinds of MC, just like there's a whole bunch of different kinds of Romex. But so you can understand what MC is, here it is. All right, next up are conduit fittings. So these are a couple of different kinds of conduit fittings, all for 3/4 conduit or tubing, depending on what you're using. There's a bunch of different styles of these too. Some of them are rain tight, so that you can be used outdoors. Some of them are just compression. They fit together really tight. And then there's set screw, which get fastened down with a screw. They're all, you know, you're gonna use all of them in many different kinds of scenarios. So just knowing like this is a connector, whereas this is a coupling. You notice there's no threading on the couplings. They just, it's a pipe in, pipe out. Whereas a connector, there's actually threading on one side that goes into a box. So your conduit stops at that box. But just knowing conduit fittings, couplings and connectors. You're gonna hear those over and over again. Couplings, connectors. Another good thing to know is the blank. So 1900 blank is something that goes on a 1900 box. And that's what you would cinch down after you get wires put in this thing. If you're gonna have a device, again, you're gonna use either an industrial cover instead of this, or you're gonna use a mud ring. But if there's not a device going in it and you're just making up joints and pushing them in the back, you're gonna use a cover. So either a 4-square cover, 1900 cover, depending on what you guys call it and what area of the country you're in. Next up is the 12x12 junction box. You're gonna use a lot of these. This is kind of a cool style from Hubble or Arlington. Same company, but they make these little stab-ins that MC goes inside of these. So you just pop these out, stick your MC in, and they already snap in place. Not gonna find a lot that look like this. This is something that I was just sent recently. But it's cool because it's got all these different knockouts. You know, you can run 1¼", 1½", 3/4", 1/2-inch conduits of all sizes. It's got some in the back. It already comes with a ground bus. But you're gonna see boxes that look this sized, where it's 4 inches deep, by 12 inches wide, by 12 inches down. These are just pretty much the same thing as a 1900 box, just a lot bigger. You can put bigger conductors, you can put more conductors inside of it. But understand when somebody says that a 12x12, they're talking about a 12x12 junction box. Another thing that you're gonna come across in commercial a lot are relays. I've got a whole different video that I've done on how relays work and what they are. But essentially just know that relays are multi-pole switches. So you can put multiple different things and switch certain loads on while other ones off, but it's an electronic remotely controlled switch. So rather than somebody having to come on and flip a light on or go and flip like 3 different lights on, somebody could hook a photocell up or flip one switch and it turn on like 3 different things while it turns off some other things. So it's a way to introduce a little bit of logic to your circuits. So just know a relay is an electromagnetic switch that you can switch multiple things with. All right, so I can't talk about the relay unless I talk about the contactor as well. So a contactor is the exact same thing as a relay. It just handles more amperage, so it's used in a little bit more beefy situations. You can get them in multiple different poles. Like this is a 4-pole contactor. This is a 3-pole that is configured as a 6-pole, but it could be a 12-pole. Another 3-pole. This is a 12-pole. So there's all different kinds of contactors that you're going to run into in commercial nonstop. And just understanding that what it does is it allows you to take one action that affects a whole bunch of different circuits at the same time. You can sometimes turn some of them on and turn some of them off at the exact same time. So it just, again, is introducing logic into a pretty analog circuit. All right, next up, we've got two things that are pretty similar, kind of the same thing, but not. Spring nuts and cone nuts. So spring nuts go inside of Unistrut or Kindorf or Strut channel or whatever you call this stuff. But they twist in there, and it allows you to have a surface to bolt onto. So it has something pushing this way and something pushing that way. A lot of people don't like them because these little things just get in the way, and they end up popping through the back and falling out and just get in the way more than anything. So cone nuts are a good alternative. I love cone nuts. It's really all I use. But the same thing, they push inside and they spin and just lock in place. And they're nice because you can slide them. There's nothing in the back, the spring like getting in the way. I just hate spring nuts. But from time to time, you gotta use them. Spring nuts and cone nuts. Next up is strut, or Kindorf, or Cantrus, or strut rack, or channel, whatever. There's so many different names for what this is. But this is what you build racks out of. So this is a really rigid material. Usually comes in 10-foot sections. Sometimes it'll come in 20-foot sections. Sometimes it's double stacked back to back. Sometimes it's thin strut that's only half this thickness. Sometimes it's, you know, this is 1 5/8. There's a 7/8 strut as well. But get used to what strut is and knowing what it's for. You're usually using it because it's so rigid to mount things to. You bolt it into concrete, you can bury it, pour fresh concrete and bury one of these, and then when the concrete dries, you get something really sturdy and rigid. All kinds of uses for these. Sometimes we even just use them to strap pipe. We'll build a service on a wall and we'll stick this behind our riser so we have something to attach our riser to on, you know, the side of a building. Next up, I'm gonna talk about two different kinds of conduit. EMT, electrical metallic tubing. This is kind of a thin-walled tubing. People call it conduit. It's actually a tubing. It's really just in forums and really super picky people that have nothing else to do with their lives that are gonna sit and pick you apart on whether or not you're calling this tubing or conduit. It doesn't matter. And the other one is rigid metal conduit. So RMC, this is really, really thick stuff. I mean, it is like heavy duty. It's really difficult to cut this stuff. It's thick walled, it's galvanized, so it's just a really super stout piece of conduit that will not rust or corrode. I mean, everything will rust and corrode after a certain amount of time in certain conditions, but this stuff lasts a really, really long time and it's damn near impossible to break. Whereas this can get crushed pretty easily, corrodes a lot easier. So just knowing what the difference is, like, you'll always be able to tell rigid when it's brand new on a shelf because it comes threaded. And when you cut this, you will have an actual threader that you can use to stick this on. Like, this end right now is not threaded, but you could stick this in a threader and actually thread new threads on it. So all of your fittings are going to be threaded. Not all of them. There are some that are non-threaded or threadless couplings. But EMT, you're never going to thread. You're always going to use couplings and connectors and stuff to put on the ends of these things. So that's the big difference, but I think you should know both rigid and EMT because you're going to use both of them on a pretty frequent basis. All right, the last one I want to cover is flex, or flexible metal conduit. Most people just call this flex, though. It's not weatherproof, it's not rain tight, so water can get in this stuff. There's usually two different types that people use. This is aluminum. I mean, you can tell it's just like super floppy, easy to break. And then this is steel. A little bit harder to work with, harder to cut, harder to break. Certain environments, certain things you're doing will require one or the other, or just whatever you got on the truck will work. Again, it just kind of depends. But knowing what it is, knowing that it's flexible metal conduit, that's the actual name of it. But most people out in the field just call it metal flex or flex. All right, my friends, so that's it. I mean, there's definitely way more of those that I can cover. I'll probably do that again in another video, but I just wanted to give any of you apprentices or people that are about to get into commercial kind of some perspective on some of the materials that we use. So let me know if you have any other questions, other suggestions. I love you crazy people, and I will see you in the next one.